You know, December is the time of year when film critics like myself are expected to divide our time between coming up with year's best lists and keeping a very close eye on year-end award ceremonies, so that we'll know what to complain about at Oscar time. Now, I've been known to pick on the Oscars in the past, but right now I'm inclined to be much nicer to them, because as stuffy, pandering, and risk-averse as the Academy Awards can be, as a film aficionado who's also a gamer, I have to give them this. At least they aren't the VGAs. You know, I think the most depressing thing about the yearly spectacle that is the Spike TV Video Game Awards is seeing it surrounded by commercials and promotions for everything else Spike TV related, and realizing that it doesn't feel incongruous at all. Look, there are few bigger champions of gaming becoming more inclusive and more part of the mainstream than me, but I can't be the only person who's a little nostalgic for a time when gaming's general demographic and Spike TV's general demographic had next to no overlap. The Age of Mario may have been far from perfect, but at least it didn't give us a medium that feels right at home on the same network that airs Mansers. This era of Madden, Master Chief, and monodimensional militaristic machismo may have brought us greater visibility, but in terms of cultural perception, all we've earned is a different flavor of disrespect. For all the millions sold and install bases expanded, the so-called archetypal gamer has basically moved from Gary and Wyatt to Chet. That's not progress. Yeah, Skyrim. Yes, it's nice that a single-player fantasy game took top honors instead of Call of Duty's most recent multiplayer map pack, but that's hardly enough to make up for things like onstage teabagging, especially since Skyrim is a massive runaway hit and the trendiest game-relating topic of the moment, so it's not exactly a huge shock. For me, the saddest thing is wondering what's going through the head of a guy like Shigeru Miyamoto attending this thing. I mean, yeah, it was great seeing him get up to accept that Hall of Fame prize, but dear lord, what must it be like to be the Leonardo f***ing Da Vinci of your medium, sitting in the audience for an awards show that gives out important prizes pre-show so they can make room for more trailers, treats Felicia Day like a glorified booth babe, and hustles the actual developers offstage so they can trot out a Jonas Brother or Charlie Sheen? Disgraceful. Remember how some folks felt that Travis from No More Heroes was supposed to be an unfairly brutal parody of American gamers and American gaming culture as seen by Japanese developers? If that's true, then this show is an argument that they were actually being way too nice. Not even Travis Touchdown would be caught dead at this kind of shindig. Hey. But yeah, the whole disgraceful display, coupled with my year-end critic activities, did give me a fun new imagination game to play, and one I'd like to share with you. What if the Oscars were the VGAs? I imagine the basic idea is self-explanatory. Here's some I came up with, but I bet some of you could do even better. If the Oscars were the VGAs, Vin Diesel would have a Lifetime Achievement Award. If the Oscars were the VGAs, Adam Sandler would have a Lifetime Achievement Award. If the Oscars were the VGAs, The Dark Knight still wouldn't have won, but Battle Los Angeles might have had a shot. If the Oscars were the VGAs, Best Editing, Best Cinematography, and Best Screenplay would be announced in a montage, but they'd devote a full segment to declaring Fast and Furious 6 Most Anticipated Movie. There'd be an award for Best Character, and David Spade would have 10 of them. The real event of the night would be a world premiere trailer for Men in Black Actually, that's not even a joke. They really are doing Men in Black 3. Pixar movies would be considered too artsy to win anything. The Lord of the Rings Return of the King would have lost Best Picture to Biker Boys in 2003. Terrence Malick and Woody Allen would have to sit in the bleachers. Armageddon, American Godzilla, Rush Hour, and I Know What You Did Last Summer would be part of a classics montage. Green Lantern would have a better shot at Best Picture than The Tree of Life.
Wow, I know, right?
Martin Scorsese would get cut off halfway through his speech and shoved off stage by a guy dressed like the Chinese and/or North Korean bad guys from the still-yet-to-be-released Red Dawn remake, so that guest MC Carlos Mencia could bring out the cast of the Starship Troopers reboot to introduce the exclusive world premiere teaser for Expendables 2. And finally, the one that I think sums up the whole bloody thought experiment, Brett Ratner would not have had to quit. I'm Bob, and that's the big picture.